One of the things that had struck us most during our stay in Serbia was without doubt the incredible strength that nationalism still held in the country. A nationalism which had played a crucial role in the devastating wars of the 90s, at the end of Yugoslavia. So it seemed just fitting that our next stop would lead us to Bosnia and Herzegovina, the exact country which had suffered most under this nationalism and its consequences. Made up of mostly Croatian Catholics, Bosnian Muslims and Orthodox Serbs, Bosnia had nearly been torn apart by its neighbours after the fall of Yugoslavia, barely surviving as a state. And although there is peace today, some conditions are still critical. To get a better understanding of Bosnia, its people and its history, we had arranged a meeting with Admir Cavalic in Tuzla, one of the country's biggest and most multicultural cities, and so our one-day intensive course of trying to understand Bosnia began.
Well, Tuzla is actually selling that story, like, because here you never had the war times clashes, you had the population of local Serbs, Croats, Bosniaks preserved before the war and after the war in the same amount. So there was never, like, inner city conflicts here in Tuzla. So actually Tuzla is branding herself as a city of multicultural in Bosnia, the city where we didn't have nationalists and so on.
While the multicultural Tuzla had managed to survive the bloody Bosnian war relatively unharmed and without ethnic cleansings, Serbian attacks had left some scars in the city centre nevertheless.
Actually, in 1995, the grenade fell here, and that's actually one of the worst events in regarding the Bosnian War in context of Tuzla. And 71 young life actually was lost here. If you read the names, you would actually see that there you have names from Bosniaks, Bosnian Serbs, and Bosnian Croatian, and others. So it was really a multi-ethnical diversity, the names of the people.
But while stories about Bosnian history were interesting and often tragic, we decided to continue our talks with Admir on a hopefully more happy topic, the present state and the future aims of his country.
Well, indeed, the Bosnia and Herzegovina, although it's a small country, it's really politically and administrative really complex country. I would say the most complex country in the world. We actually have more than 100 ministers. We have 13 prime ministers and we have 3 presidents. Meaning that Bosnia has one state government. After that, we have 2 entity governments, and one entity that is called Federation of Bosnia and Herzegovina has 10 cantons, and each of the cantons actually has its own prime minister and 10 or 12 ministers. After that, we have municipalities, we have cities, and so on. And all of this is actually created so that 3 nations could live in peace in Bosnia and Herzegovina, and we have 3 nations that are the majority is Bosniaks, they're mostly Muslims, and after that you have Bosnian Serbs that are mostly Orthodox, and after that you have Bosnian Croats that are mostly Catholic religion. Well, generally I think the problem is that we have 50 years of communists here, and actually the communists they created a fake, I would say a fake integration. Meaning, of course, we gave representatives of different nations in politics and so on, and Tito was a dictator. But after Tito who was really a charming leader, a charming dictator. After he died, everything fell apart because you didn't have the key factor of integration of people, and I truly believe that's market, like the free market or the economy that is actually integrating people. And the fact that we are trading together, that we are working together, that we are making our lives better, actually, I think that's the key factor of integration of different nations.
After hearing first things about the difficult structures and problems of Bosnia and Tuzla, our next step was Sarajevo. Just one-fourth as big as Belgrade, it was captured somewhere between its bloody history, its societal divisions, and its vibrant youth. But while the graveyards of the 5-year siege victims are spread all over the city and remind locals as well as tourists of the horrors of the war, the general attitude in the city seems forward-looking. At least according to Nejra, a local student active in the ESN network.
I can't say that we are fighting today, like 20 years after the war. We are not fighting between ourselves, but there is some indirect tensions. But the people who is actually making those tensions, and mostly the politicians, which are probably trying to, you know, prolong their mandate with Serbs. We understand each other better with Serbs, like Serbian people from Serbia, better than with those Orthodox ones which are living in that Republic of Srpska. Because they kind of, you know, we have our story, they have their story, we can't agree about it. With the Croatian, it's a little bit different, you know, it's more easygoing, there weren't so many conflicts between the Muslim part and the Croatian, the Catholics, as much as with the Orthodox part. So you can feel the tension. Really, if we could kind of, you know, isolate, don't let our heads be filled with the stories of our parents, especially those negative stories, I think that people could get around, you know, like, it would be much better. Do you have, like, comments, like, I can, you know, I can recognize a Muslim by the, I know, by the way they look. Well, what's the difference between, I know, you, me, and every other, like, student, young man, young woman in the world? There is actually nothing that I can say, okay, that's really characteristic, especially in the Balkans. So
our talks with Admir, Nejra and many more people we had met in Bosnia had taught us a lot about the theoretical functioning of the country and how life there works today. Both Tuzla and Sarajevo were highly multicultural cities, but when travelling eastwards passing the Republic of Srpska, we were suddenly in for a very big surprise. Without passing any visible border, it really seemed as if we were back in Serbia.
What's happening?
I don't know, we have just stopped in some random village because we saw there are a lot of people walking by the street. Asked some girl about it, and apparently there's some nice... Apparently there's some nice Serbian feast going on. And we'll go and check it out. Bam, drink some pivo.
Stranded in some random village with local Bosnian Serbs celebrating a Christian Orthodox holiday, we suddenly felt far, far away from the mosques and the minarets of Sarajevo. Although it has come a long way since the end of the war, Bosnia's internal divisions are still striking, and although many people say that things will become better, there are enough who doubt it. But at least for now, things seem to be quiet and steady, developing for the better. And so we use the village festival to say goodbye to Bosnia, enjoy its great food once more, and prepare ourselves for our upcoming trip to Kosovo.